from their use since the early 20th century in ubiquitous non-stick and water-repellent consumer products, as well as in firefighting foams, PFAS have gradually entered the environment and drinking water supplies, and now our bodies, yours, mine, probably everybody that watches this video has some level of PFAS in their system. As a result, PFAS represent one of the most daunting environmental and public health challenges of our lifetimes. Heather Lanza is one of the experts taking on the challenge of understanding PFAS risk. She studies how PFAS accumulates in ecosystems and in animals, including humans. Her work has taken her around the world and to the leading edge of PFAS investigation and assessment. Well, Heather, thank you for being here. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Andrew. I'm excited to be here.
For as long as I've been following along on, you know, issues related to PFAS, PFAS toxicology has been an emerging field of study. So as we sit here today, what have we learned about how PFAS affects the human body? What do we know so far?
It's a great question. And, you know, unfortunately, there's still a lot of uncertainty that remains, despite the fact that we have been researching PFAS for such a long period. We see that there's associations with various health effects like increased cholesterol levels, decreased vaccine response in children, things like that. But we don't have a good handle at this point on how exactly PFAS are directly interacting with the body, the mode of action that those compounds are exerting on the biological systems. And so that certainly remains a key area of toxicological research.
So I read about a recent Harvard study that seemed to suggest that PFAS exposure can affect risk to COVID-19. So can you comment on that? And, you know, is that a COVID-19 issue, or does that apply sort of broadly to a variety of viruses that could be out there affecting humans?
It's a great question. And, you know, unfortunately, again, this remains a key area of uncertainty. At the moment, the data suggests that PFAS may affect vaccine response in children, but we don't have a good handle at this point on vaccine response effects in adults. And certainly we know that COVID-19 tends to affect adults more severely than it does children. So this remains a key area of uncertainty. That study that you're mentioning, from earlier this year, showed a relationship between PFBA concentrations in the blood and increased severity of COVID-19. But this is pretty interesting because PFBA is a short-chain PFAS compound, and as such, it's excreted much more rapidly than the long-chain PFAS compounds like PFOS and PFOA. So there could be some potential for confounding. Perhaps, you know, exposures to PFAS occurring during the medical treatment may be suggesting a relationship when in fact these two observations that increase PFBA concentration in the serum and the increased severity of COVID-19 may be unrelated. But either way, certainly there's a lot more research to be done. And the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry, or the ATSDR, has concluded that more research is needed to better understand this topic.
So there's a huge fear factor, right, when it comes to communities being exposed to PFAS. So in your view, what's the most important thing that drinking water utilities and municipal authorities that are trying to communicate with their customers around PFAS risk, what's the most important thing they can do to be successful in that communication?
It's another great question, and I think it's really going to vary on the community, but I would say that the most important things would be to be transparent and to be honest, right? I think pretending that we do have all the answers right now is not the best approach to take, because there is so much uncertainty, because we are seeing these regulations change on, you know, almost a daily basis. We, as more information becomes available, we have to reset and we have to reevaluate how we approach these compounds moving forward. And so my recommendation would be to, you know, be as open and communicate with the community as much as possible throughout the process and kind of bring them along for the ride, if you will, because this is something that we're all in together.
Excellent. Well, Heather, thank you so much for joining me today. This has been fascinating.
Of course, Andrew. Thank you for having me.
If you enjoyed this interview, subscribe to Breaking Down PFAS, a newsletter that brings you the latest breaking news and dispatches from the front lines of active treatment, emerging regulation, and R&D projects. Learn more and sign up at cdmsmith.com/PFAS.